Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today I'm speaking with clinical psychologist Dr. Arielle Schwartz. Today we're talking about trauma recovery, PTSD, complex PTSD, and what healing looks like. I hope you enjoy the conversation. Hi, Dr. Schwartz. How are you?
I'm doing well today. It's snowy here, so I'm kind of enjoying a cozy day. How are you?
I am great. It's a very rainy day here in Vancouver, so typical Vancouver day. Is it okay if I call you Arielle?
Yes, please.
Okay. So, geez, there's so much to talk about here. We're talking about trauma recovery, PTSD, how we heal. And it's, you know, it's a hard place to know where to start because I personally feel like we're all walking around with trauma. But I don't think we understand what trauma is and how it affects our health. So maybe we could start there with you.
I think that's a great place to start. And I think that especially right now in the world, as we're emerging in a time just post-pandemic, that I think we're all trying to find our way and trying to orient to what just happened. What have we been through? What are we still going through? One of the pieces that I'm going to kind of actually use as a lead in to respond to your question about what is trauma and how does it impact our health is actually a little bit of research about the individuals who are experiencing long haul COVID and kind of worsened responses to our pandemic experience. And what we're seeing is that the individuals that had pre-existing trauma, especially developmental trauma or adverse life experiences, had a harder time and had more health consequences in response to COVID. So that is a lens into something that we've long understood about trauma and what is happening in the body and what are the lingering post-traumatic symptoms. But if we look at what is trauma, we typically think that it's anything that is overwhelming our coping capacities. And our coping capacities are not just our mind, but it's very much our body. It's our autonomic nervous system. It's how well we're able to recalibrate, recover from stress, right? We can think of stress and trauma as living on a continuum. And that whatever feels like a threat to our well-being is going to lead us to go into some kind of protective self-defense. We might freeze initially. We might go into a fight response or a flight response. Or maybe at some point we feel like nothing we do is going to work and it can lead us to shut down. And those kinds of lingering responses to threat, whether that lives on the stress or trauma continuum, if it doesn't resolve into a sense of completion or satisfaction or empowerment, or I had my voice and I was effective in the world, I was able to say no to that event and it stopped, right? We need to feel that we have some efficacy in response to what happens. And when we don't have that, these lingering impacts in our body, our autonomic nervous system, they live unresolved. And they're trying to find their way to resolution. We want to come to completion with this.
Doesn't it seem that we live in, I don't know if it's the time we live in or if society's always been like this, that, you know, we just need to pick ourselves up and get on with it. Like we have, you know, we have responsibilities and they can't be wallowing in your sadness, Arielle. We can't just, you know, we need to, you know, yes, that happened when you were a kid and now you're not, you're an adult. So let's, come on, get over it.
Right. That kind of dismissive or discounting of the impact of life events. And when that's a predominant message that we're receiving either from our family of origin or from the culture at large, it has rather detrimental effects because it leads us to try and override what is really true for us. And, you know, there is something to be said about sometimes just moving on or getting back on the bicycle after you've fallen off, right? There's something to be said about our power to overcome simply because we're willing to reengage with life. But overriding isn't really ultimately a great strategy in the long run, right? Because the body, these imbalances, if we're not able to rest, and we're stuck in go, 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 it will wear and tear at our well-being, right? We don't actually get to digest well. We don't sleep well, right? These kinds of lingering physiological impacts. Or conversely, if we feel like we are stuck in shame or despair or some kind of collapse or shutdown or withdrawal from the world, it can lead us into these kind of lingering feelings of depression. What's the point? Nothing I do is going to make a difference. And that has a whole other array of health consequences.
So what is the difference between PTSD, which is post-traumatic stress disorder, and CPSD?
Yeah, CPTSD.
CPTSD, there's that extra, the complex part of it. Is there a difference? Exactly. There's so many letters here. So is there a difference between the two? Does all trauma lead to PTSD, which leads to complex PTSD?
No, not necessarily. So, you know, sometimes trauma is a single incident, right? We're looking at something like, I don't know, we had fires in our community, that comes immediately to mind, or there was a car accident, or there's, some kind of traumatic loss that we faced. We witnessed a shooting. I mean, these are part of our world, especially here in the U.S. right now. So we have a specific incident, and it stands alone. It's maybe we've had a relatively secure upbringing, and then this incident happens, and we need support to process that incident, to digest it, to integrate. How do we move forward from that event? How do we make sense of our world? My house burned down, or the scary thing happened. That does not necessarily lead to complex trauma. The complex element of this, which is now CPTSD, complex post-traumatic stress disorder, is when there has been an ongoing, repeated, unrelenting, kind of long-term experience of trauma. And very often it's relational trauma, some experience of betrayal in the relational arena. I don't know who to trust, where to go to turn, right? Maybe my childhood home was filled with strife or abuse or ongoing neglect. Maybe there was this experience of I never felt understood for who I am in the world. And then on top of that, we're still navigating the same complex world, right? Where a pandemic happens or where we experience social losses or complexities. And so the experience of the repeated ongoing relational wounds that impair my sense of self, right? It's not just like this thing happened and it's impairing how I relate to that or that one experience. It impairs my overall identity. Who am I in the world? Am I good enough? Am I worthy of love? Do I deserve to exist? It's those kinds of really core dilemmas that exist within that CPTSD arena.
Yes, that makes sense. So another word that we hear often is resilience. And I used to really appreciate that word, but now I find that it's almost like it's an expectation that we are resilient, or, you know, you're a failure if you're not resilient, or the goal is to be resilient. The goal is to be like, you know, almost like Wonder Woman, where you have your wristbands on and you're just like, you know, everything is, you're ricocheting off of you because you're so resilient. Can you talk us through resilience, and is that the goal?
I think I'm going to hopefully help you reappreciate the word, because okay. we want to tease it apart from what you were saying earlier, this idea that somehow to be resilient means you just have to pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You just have to keep on going on. And that is actually not what resilience is meant to be. Resilience is actually about our access to resource. It's about our access to support, that in order to adapt well in the face of adversity, which is what our definition of resilience is, it's not just an internal access to a set of skills or tools, although we can, that can be part of the picture. It's a great part of the picture, but it's not the whole picture. Because in order to build that internal capacity to adapt well, we really need access to compassionate care, to places where we can be vulnerable, right? Vulnerability is actually a very key component of resilience. To places where we can kind of unpack that suitcase that we're dragging around with us, with our pain and our loss and our shame and so on and so forth, and feel safe enough to have that be held in a shared space where someone can say, I'm willing to sit with you in relationship to your pain. And it's through that experience of belonging and reclaiming relational safety that we begin to start to feel ourselves less alone in the world. And as a result, we soften, our heart softens, our belly softens. We can start to reclaim our breath again, right? We need the safe relational spaces to do this well. And so resilience isn't just about me alone in the world with my Wonder Woman bands, right? It's about me with a team that's willing to stand by my side, and together we can navigate those challenges.
Mm, I see. So it is a good word, which I think it is a good word and a good place to be, but that I've never heard it described the way you just described it. So you mentioned having a team and having, you know, support. That is not something that's accessible for everybody, right? So if somebody's listening right now and they're like, well, I wish I had a team, or I wish somebody would listen to me, or I wish I could access that, or I don't have the funds to, you know, see a psychologist, or my doctor won't, you know, there's a, where we are, and I'm sure it's the same, you know, healthcare workers everywhere are overworked, they're burnt out, they have their own personal challenges from the past 3 years, and it's not easy to find care or help, or never mind just asking for it. That's its own challenge sometimes. So what are some of your recommendations for people that don't have access to care?
Yeah, I think you're really speaking to one of the biggest barriers that we're facing, and this probably is maybe the biggest crisis that we're facing in our world right now, is knowing how to access the resources that we so badly need. In fact, it's been one of the most motivating elements for me for most of my career, is to increase access not only to information, but also to kind of contact into a sense of community. But, you know, there are, just as much as there are, you know, healthcare providers that are burnt out, that there are, you know, kind of lack of access to affordable healthcare and affordable mental health care, there are also many, many individuals who are really invested in creating safe care environments. And one of the gifts of the pandemic, if we might call it this, is that a lot of people took their work online. And a lot of people created some really beautiful community spaces online where we can start to go in at either donation-based or at low-cost, accessible connections within community, both for grief and loss and also for trauma recovery. So starting to know, how do I find those groups? Where are they located? Where can I access that kind of support? I would say that, you know, there's certain ones that I know of in part because I've been, kind of connected with them across this time. There's others that I would say, if you start to Google, if you start to search around, if you even know that there's people offering these kinds of offerings, we start to look for them and we go, oh, wow, there's that support group online I can join. There's this one here. And when I'm, you know, looking at the factors linked to resilience, one of the most number one factors is not isolating. The willingness to stay involved, to step into community. And you said something earlier that was really important. There's both the access to care, access to connection, but then there's also the willingness to reach, the willingness to ask for it or to look for it. And sometimes that's the other barrier that we really need to attend to, is that we might kind of go into this place of hopelessness where there's nothing out there, there's no one out there, no one will care. And I really, truly believe, and I'll borrow from Mr. Rogers here, Fred Rogers, for a moment, of saying that we have to know how to look for the helpers, that in any crisis, being pandemic being one of them, we have to know that there are good people out there doing good things who really care.
Yes. And what about, you know, I found personally that I always convince myself that, you know, my trauma is not as bad as somebody else's. So it's not really a very big deal and I can deal with this and I can, you know, and I, you know, it's not as bad as somebody else's. And so I shouldn't complain. You must hear this.
Oh, of course, we can hear it on both sides of the continuum. Mine is no big deal, right? The dismissive voice, or mine is the worst ever and no one can handle mine because you know, it would turn everybody away. And so actually knowing that there is no trauma that's too big or too small, and that, you know, whether it's something that for you feels like, oh gosh, other people might think it's no big deal, but guess what? If it's important to you, it's important. And if it's in some way or another lingering, if even the dismissive voice, if you're finding yourself kind of playing down something that's really, that really actually does bother you, that was a learned experience, right? Who played down your upsets, your hurts? Who dismissed those? Because we internalize those experiences from what we learned relationally.
So another thing that I learned about recently was dissociation. I didn't know about that word, but I do know what it means, and I think I want you to explain what that means. And I'm going to guess that a large majority of us do this. A lot.
You're listening correctly. And I think it's one of the pieces that's been kind of at the heart of a lot of the writing that I do, especially starting with the Complex PTSD Workbook, was to depathologize the understanding of dissociation and to actually kind of hold it in this recognition that indeed most of us do some version of this. And dissociation lives on a continuum. So in its most basic sense, it's a protective mechanism that disconnects us from what we're feeling and what we're sensing in our body, from our emotions and our bodily sensations. And we disconnect from that typically in two ways. One is that we disconnect kind of psychologically. We disconnect by going into our heads instead of feeling our bodies. Or we disconnect by scrolling social media or the internet. And that's one of the common ways, right? But we also dissociate as a very core survival mechanism. So if you have survived trauma, if you've experienced that, dissociation may have come in to cut you off from the threats that were in your environment, to actually not have to feel the impact of that because it was overwhelming, it was too much, you didn't have the coping resources at the time. So as we reassociate, as we heal from dissociation, it requires our willingness to turn towards the very things that feel absolutely terrifying to turn towards, right? Our fear, our terror, our shame, our loneliness, our despair, right? Objectively painful emotions. But the more that we avoid them, the more that we don't want to touch that, the more that it reinforces within us, it's good we're not touching that because that would be really bad. It might actually kill me to touch that feeling. Now, actually, we can, with right support, we can turn towards those objectively scary, disturbing feelings or memories. And with right support, we can recognize that they don't have to have that same kind of power over us anymore, that we can stay present in the here and now. And you'll see me do something for a moment, which is to really look around your space and to orient towards the cues that let you know you are safe now, which hopefully is the case. And I know that there's some of you who will be listening who say, but I'm not safe now. My world still is a threatening environment. And if that's the case, then that's the priority, right? That we really need to hone in on how do you find a safe enough space to heal? Because we need that. The body is not going to release the impact of trauma until we're safe enough to do so.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Oh, I have so many questions for you. Okay, before I come at you with a whole bunch more questions, we always like to thank our guests for being here. And so we ask our guests to choose a Canadian nonprofit that we can give $500 to in your name. And you chose Water First. I'm so happy you chose Water First. They support Indigenous communities in addressing critical water challenges. And that is a big problem here in Canada. And I really appreciate you choosing them, but we'll be giving them $500 in your name. So thank you very much.
Thank you. It is so meaningful to me. And I was really deeply touched when I received that ask from you. And I love that you do this because for me, this actually ties into our topic today in such a deep way because so much of, I think, how we move forward in the face of adversities in life is actually creating a meaningful life. And when we take action steps that bring us meaning, it uplifts us. When we choose to be of service to something that's outside of us or larger than us, it moves us beyond just the myopic view of our own pain and struggle into really feeling like I'm here with a purpose. I'm here and my presence makes a difference in the world. So thank you.
Thank you. So when I was reading about you and on your website, there's a lot about somatic therapy. And I've seen that word somatic therapy, and I didn't really know what it meant. I'm somebody who's done a lot of talk therapy, and then I looked up somatic therapy and I saw that it's all about touch, and I'm not gonna lie, it really freaked me out. And I just thought, I can't think of a bigger nightmare than going somewhere and somebody's gonna like touch me and like hold my head or whatever it might be. You're going to explain this a lot better than I am. I'm making it sound like a nightmare. But for some of us, it is a real, like that's scary.
Totally scary. First of all, I love how forthright you are about your own edges. I mean, it's a beautiful and authentic quality. And I think a lot of people relate to what you're saying. The other thing that I'll say is I actually just want to name that body psychotherapy, which is what somatic psychology is actually a whole range of practices, and only some of them work with touch. I personally don't work with touch as a somatic therapist, in part because it's probably an edge for me as well, right? And I do, that said, really thoroughly enjoy receiving touch-based work. For example, receiving a massage or receiving cranial sacral, because I value it so much. And as you're naming, within the psychotherapeutic arena, because we're going to these very depth places in our soul, to combine that with also being in a deeply vulnerable place where someone might place their hands on us, that can be too much for many, many people. So the body psychotherapy in a broader sense is really about building body awareness or somatic awareness within the therapeutic work. Also very vulnerable, right? I'm going to move beyond telling the story into really sensing and feeling how those events have shaped me, have impacted me, have landed in me. And I'm going to recollect myself as I reflect upon those memories and gather in what ways have I kind of built tension patterns in my body that have disconnected me from my heart, right? I've braced in the chest or have cut off my ability to breathe fully. And so therefore I don't feel my emotions fully. Or maybe it's hard for me to have my voice in the world and I hold a lot of tension in my throat. And these are, again, very common life experiences. And when we work through the body, we're really working with sensing and feeling these blockages that we've many of us have internalized and kind of adopted throughout our life experiences. They've become who we are, but this recognition that we can actually reshape ourselves. We can reorganize around those events so that I no longer have to feel like it's not okay for me to reach for support. I no longer have to feel frozen in relationship to feeling like someone might come towards me and it might not be safe. So we re-empower through the body. And whether that is repatterning through recognizing that you can move your body now, you are no longer trapped in a situation where you're held down, right? I'm thinking about working with someone who maybe had been sexually assaulted and couldn't protect herself, right? She can push through her arms, she can use her voice and say no, she can stand up and move her feet and recognize she's no longer stuck in that situation. So our bodies can help us recognize that it's over because we no longer have to embody that pattern. We can do something new.
Yes. Okay. I can appreciate that because I think that the idea of it for so many people is it feels incredibly vulnerable and it's so hard to be vulnerable. It's really difficult for some people. Some of us have, I don't know, maybe some people are easily I don't know. I have no idea. I only know my own experience. But where does vulnerability fit into all of this?
Yeah. I often like to say that vulnerability can be reframed as a strength rather than a weakness. And that when we are turning towards that softening of that defensiveness, the willingness to be close to someone without feeling like we have to self-protect or keep them at arm's length, right? So vulnerability is also about intimacy. And it's about, it doesn't have to be sexual intimacy, it's about emotional intimacy, right? It's about a willingness to let someone in and also allow someone else to fully receive you so that I no longer feel quite so alone in the world.
Because we can be surrounded by lots of people, big families, and still be incredibly lonely.
Yes, yes. And I think that that what you were naming earlier around some of the cultural norms of just being strong and pushing through certainly can reinforce this idea that it's not okay to share with others how I really feel.
How does trauma, whether it came, early in life or later in life, how does our trauma, or can we call it unresolved trauma? I'm not sure. How does it affect our relationships, whether it be, you know, our partner, our own children, our parents, our work, our coworkers? I mean, I would think that it would affect everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to add in a new term here, right? In service of trying to like take therapeutic lingo and make it more kind of well understood. So the new term I'll add is attachment trauma. And when we're speaking about attachment or trauma, we're talking about our earliest relationships. And ideally, in our very early relationships, our caregiver relationships with our primary caretakers, whether our parents, birth parents, adopted parents, even grandparents, or other primary caretakers, those shape our relational expectancies in the world. What it is that we expect out of relationships are very well kind of imprinted or patterned in our earliest relationships. And if we had someone that was predictable, reliable, caring, nurturing, protective when they needed to be, right? That's going to, in a way, kind of wire in that other people are trustworthy, other people really care. I know if I go out and ask for help, someone will be there. And when we've had attachment trauma or attachment wounds, we may have had very different experiences. For example, we might have had the experience that people were very unpredictable. I never knew when they were going to pay attention to me or really care. Or maybe we had the experience that no one ever really came. Or maybe we had the experience that relationships are threatening, right? That people hurt me if I get close. And if we had those kinds of wounds and we go forward into our adult relationships without being awake to that, without being aware of how we've been shaped, we're more likely to kind of recapitulate or repeat those relational experiences by choosing partners, perhaps, that are similar to what we know, right? Another partner who maybe doesn't really attend to us, or a partner who's very unreliable, or someone who's threatening. Or maybe we become like that in the world, right? We're not available, or we, are unreliable for other people or threatening. And so when we really get to know our own attachment history, we can create meaningful change in the kinds of relationships we choose. We go, oh, wow, huh, I know I'm drawn to that person, but why, right? Oh, wait a second, they're kind of reminding me of. And then we can start to make some new choices. And if we've had, and therapy often offers this, if we've had a new relational experience that we feel like, oh, I know what that feels like now, to be cared for, to be validated, to really be seen and known, then I'm more likely to go, that feels like that. That's what love feels like. And when we learn to love ourselves and be so patient and so compassionate inside, we're more likely to be able to really choose what matches that feeling as well.
Yes, totally. Except it's so hard to do sometimes, you know? It's like, I wish it was easier for so many people, because I think what people who maybe haven't done talk therapy or any kind of therapy, really, it's exhausting. Like, I mean, that's how I would describe it to somebody. And for people I know that also, are in therapy, they all say the same thing. And it's a different kind of exhaustion, right? And it can really like just put you out for the day, like after a session sometimes. Not every time, but that's sometimes sort of hard for others to understand. But I guess trauma is hard to understand.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And I think the exhaustion that you're speaking about is because we are actually like rewiring our brain and our biology. I mean, it is a very deep process. You might just be, you know, again, kind of talking about something, but even if you're talking about something, very likely you're starting to feel. You're starting to feel the impact of those events. You're starting to feel the tenderness and what it was like for you at various phases of your life. It's like a life review in a sense, and you're going back and finding parts of yourself that got stuck in times that remained unresolved in your heart and maybe never got witnessed by another person in the world. So we reveal all of that. And that is a tremendous kind of courage that I often liken to a hero or heroine's journey, right? We don't recognize that often it's not so much about going out in the world to fight the dragon and find the princess or the chalice. It's going internal. It's going inside of yourself to know your own shadows and to know your tender spots.
Oh, wow. Yes. So is it possible to feel better?
Oh, of course. I wouldn't be in this work.
I know, but I want you, I want people who are listening who don't, you know, because there are times, and as you know, as you're moving through, you know, the waves and, you know, and some of them are small little waves and some of them are, you know, soul crushers, like they are hard. It can feel like it doesn't get better, you know, but it does get better. It can get better.
Yes, 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 by all means. And as we've already named here, it doesn't mean that it immediately feels better, right? That there is a certain amount of that willingness to go towards something that feels hard and that it might feel exhausting, right? It might feel like you're going to the gym and working out and you're sore, you know, emotionally. But the other side of that is that we have a greater sense of what's possible. We are more willing to show up in the world and to actually know that we can do something hard and still be strong and come out even stronger on the other side, right? We put in that hard work to be with something like hopelessness, to be with despair, to touch our own shame, the untouchable place within us that we think everybody, if they knew that about me, they would reject me, right? They would absolutely never want to talk to me again. And if we are willing to go there and love that part of ourselves and allow that to be loved within the safe therapeutic arena, we start to build this capacity that actually maybe I'm not so bad. Maybe other people would see that I'm not so bad.
You are amazing. I really, I've loved this conversation. So thank you very much. I really have. Your website is drarielleschwartz.com. There's lots on your website. All your books are there. Everything's there. So I highly recommend talking, you know, about accessibility and that. Your website is a great place to start to look for, you know, nuggets that can help, really, truly. And obviously your books. And you are on Instagram, but you put most of your stuff on Facebook.
Yeah.
And yeah. I'm sure there's a lot of stuff on Facebook that, and people can find you, Dr. Arielle Schwartz, on Facebook. Thank you so much for everything. I really appreciate this conversation.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.